for Sanskrit, as all of you know, Travancore, Trivandrum, Kochi, Tripunithura, and Kalikach, Kozhikode. All these royal families have great contribution to the field of Sanskrit learning. Many of the members of these royal families were great scholars and poets themselves. They have also encouraged poets and scholars from different parts of India. Other royal families like Kodungallur, Kollam, what we call Vayanad in our literary scholarly history, Kottayam near Kozhikode, what we call the North Kottayam, the great king, many great kings who have nourished, promoted Shastras like Mimamsa and Kerala theatrical art forms like Kathakali. And such minor royal families, other royal families also have contributed to Sanskrit studies in equal ways. So the royal families like art and literature are also significant and worth mentioning. Encourage and continue even now in many ways in Kerala fruitfully. Sanskrit colleges and similar institutions were established all over the country in the modern way by the royal families themselves, which were later fully taken over by the government in the present system. Government Sanskrit College Tripunithura, established by the royal patron, His Highness King Rajarshi Ramavarma of Kochi, 106 years ago in 1914, has passed through various stages of its development over these more than 100 years and has reached the zenith of its present glory. As all of us know, today, January 14th is the 106th Founders Day of the college, and we are very happy, we are very glad, we are very into, proud to remember the great scholar, His Highness Ramavarma, who has founded this college. In the same way, in Kerala, Sanskrit colleges of Pattambi and Trivandrum, etc., also have been started, which have been developed in the modern scenario in many ways, imparting Sanskrit education, and in some colleges, modern education also. It is a delightful and enchanting experience to recall the efforts of Ramavarma, Rajarshi Ramavarma, and his nephew, Ramavarma Parikshit Tambura, both of them mainly, who had undertaken efforts for the nursing and nurturing of the Sanskrit College Tripunithura, and it is encouraging to the present generation of scholars, teachers and students of Sanskrit. Studying about the past is not merely to know the past, as Professor Varkeri has stated in his lecture. Studying about the past is not merely to understand the past and to have a kind of hangover of its glories or hangover of the glories of the past, but study of the past should enable us to acquire more strength and vigor to open new and fruitful paths in the field effectively. The history of Cochin royal family goes back to the 14th century Common Era, most of the kings of the family had the names like Rajaraja, Ramavarma and Kerala Varma. All of them were great scholars and poets and at the same time patrons and patrons of poets and scholars also. Rajarshi Ramavarma was also the founder of the present college, was also a great scholar in Sanskrit and Shastras, and was the prince among the scholars and the scholar among the princes, as Balagangadhara Tilak has glorified him once when they both met at Pune for the All India Ayurveda Conference. It has been recorded in the history. Rajarshi Ramavarma participated in the All India Ayurveda Conference in Pune in his young days, and then Balagangadhara Tilak was there. And hearing his lecture and meeting him, Balagangadhara Tilak commented in this way, "I have heard of this prince of Kochi, Rajarshi Ramavarma, and now I understand that he is a prince among the scholars and a scholar among the princes." This is the comment of Balagangadhara Tilak. Actually, Ramavarma was such a personality. He was a prince among the scholars and a scholar among the princes of that time. Ramavarma, during the celebration of his 60th birthday in 1912, announced his intention to establish a center for advanced studies in Sanskrit Shastras in the traditional way. His noble idea was to preserve the traditional knowledge of Shastras in Sanskrit and to impart the same into the future generation effectively. A good amount of money was sanctioned from the government treasury. Then the government treasury means the royal government, government of his own. He sanctioned a very considerable amount for the starting of the college from his treasury. There was differences of opinion of many kinds at that time regarding the allotting of such a huge amount for the purpose of Sanskrit education from the government treasury as matters of equal importance or more importance related to the needs of the daily in a period of 100 years. In a century, the money and effort invested for the purpose will become fruitful. This was his reaction against the criticism from the people who opposed the action. Surely, the foresight of the king had its positive, long-ending effect in the field of Sanskrit education in Kerala in the later period, and the present Sanskrit College is a existing example of his foresight. After that, it was in 1914, the college came into existence, the Pathashala, the basic institution, came into existence. After that, the institution passed through different stages of its development till it reached its present phase in the modern time as an academic center, as a full-fledged college imparting Sanskrit education in the field of Shastras. In 1962, the institution was affiliated to the Kerala University, which can be called mainly the second stage of its development. The 5 decades prior to the affiliation to the college, to the Kerala University, a firm foundation to the Sanskrit education was laid by the founder Rajarshi Ramavarma and following him, his nephew, great scholar and poet Parikshit Thampuran. In the 5 decades, Before, it was affiliated to the Kerala University in 1962. Professor P.K. Ramachandraya was the principal in this crucial period of transition in the second stage. With a rare insight, Professor Ramachandra Iyer redesigned the courses in Sanskrit in the modern way, affiliating to the university system. Degree and postgraduate courses were started in the coming years in different branches of learning in Sanskrit. Still again, in 1980s, the college got a new vigor and a strength when the students who have passed the MA in the university stream from the college, they were appointed as the teachers there, and they began to involve in the administrative setup of the college also. Professor K.G. Paulos took charge as the principal and coordinating the teachers, students and the public. He, with his colleagues, Professor Gangadharan Nair, so many great scholars and teachers who were students of that college were working there as teachers. So coordinating all them, coordinating the public, Professor, under the leadership of the principal, Paulos, he introduced many new innovative activities in the college for the development of Sanskrit studies. The publication section was strengthened and many new important publications from Tripunatra Sanskrit series, Ramavarma series, were brought out under the leadership of Dr. K.G. Paulos. Also, a very prestigious program in national, international level, Parikshit Memorial Lecture, was also started in the college in 1988. Scholars of national and international reputation like Kapila Valsiyan, Sheldon Pollack, Dr. U.R. Anandamurthy, Dr. K.N. Panikkar, Dr. George Cardona, Dr. Padma Subramaniam, David Strowman, Dr. R.K. Sharma, so many scholars delivered lectures in the Parikshit Memorial Lecture. That lecture is even continuing even now. The research journal Purnatrayi was also started as a result of the joint venture of the teachers who were the students, the new generation in the college. So many new innovative programs for promoting Sanskrit were started at that time with a group, very strong group, led by Dr. Paulos and other senior teachers. There were many instances when the college has to face various kinds of problems and threats also in the various stages of its development. The need of the time demanded the introduction of new courses other than Sanskrit in a context, as the college was a government college, and so it has to meet the needs of all of the area or of the country, of the region. But it did not happen with the joint effort of the group there. It did not happen, and the identity of the college as a Sanskrit college was continued. When plus two courses instead of pre-degree courses were introduced, and they were detached from the colleges and attached to the higher high school system as higher secondary courses, or in the higher secondary system, all plus two courses from the colleges were detached. This affected the Sanskrit education in Kerala very much, as plus two courses in Sanskrit which were the feeding courses for BA and MA, etc., in Sanskrit, in Sanskrit colleges, were shifted from there and attached to the higher secondary schools. In other Sanskrit colleges of Kerala, this kind of shifting affected the Sanskrit education very much. But only in Tripunithura, plus two in Sanskrit was retained in the Sanskrit higher secondary school attached to the Oriental Sanskrit school in the same premises, in the same compound where the Sanskrit college is working. So, which is running in the same compound, which gives facilities for Sanskrit education. But so the high school is there, then the higher secondary school is there, and the college is there. So, from fifth standard onwards, Sanskrit education is being imparted in that complex, in that premises, though in different institutions, all under the government administration. Perhaps in Kerala, now only Tripunithura Sanskrit College and Higher Secondary College and High School. This system only will be there where Sanskrit education is being imparted from the fifth standard up to the university level in a complex jointly. That is a very important peculiarity of Tripunithura Sanskrit education at present. After affiliating the college to the Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, research courses also started there, recognizing the college as a research center. Thus, it can be said that Tripunithura is the only center of Sanskrit education now in Kerala, where studies in Sanskrit take place from fifth standard up to 10th, then plus two or higher secondary, then courses, college courses, BA and MA, and then research in the institutions controlled by the government of Kerala, situated in a complex of buildings in a particular area. Recently, the present government of Kerala has sanctioned a huge amount for the construction of new buildings for the college, with all modern facilities, which will give a new attractive face to the institution. That building construction is in the stage of completion. This can be called as the fourth stage or the latest stage in the development of the college. Hope the college will have its further development in the future also, in so many dimensions, in science studies, research, and academic area. So, the institution founded by Rajarshi Ramavarma in 1914 has now expanded, has now developed in very many ways and reached the present zenith of its glory. The lovers of Sanskrit and teachers and students of Sanskrit are surely greatly indebted to His Highness Ramavarma Parikshit Tamburan of Kochi Royal Family, the founder of the college, for all the development and prosperity that the institution has gained in the course of its development during more than 100 years. The insight, the power of determination, love for Sanskrit and Shastra scholarship, and desire to preserve it, etc., of the king resulted in such a success in the development of the college. The unique feature of Tripunithura Sanskrit College in the nurturing and strengthening of the wisdom in Sanskrit Shastras is surely the Shastra Sadas or Vakyartha Sadas being conducted in the college. This was also started by the founder, Rajarshi Rama Varma. In December every year, Shastra Sadaswar was organized in the residence of the founder in connection with his birthday, which used to last for 1 week. Scholars in Sanskrit Shastras from Kerala and all over South India used to assemble for the Sadas every year, accepting the invitation of His Highness. From 1926, the Shastra Sadas began to be conducted in the college. Reputed scholars from South India considered it as a rare honor when they got an opportunity to participate in the Sadas. In the Vakyartha Sadas every year, scholars in Shastras were honored with titles like Panditarajan and Sahitya Nipunan. In the time of Rajarshi Rama Varma, this Vakyartha Sadas was going on with great pomp and attraction. Even scholars from other states used to participate. Scholars from other states or lovers of Sanskrit from other parts used to come and attend the seminar, the Shastra Sadas, because it was conducted in such a very great manner, academic way. After Rajarshi Rama Varma, his nephew and great scholar and poet Rama Varma Parikshit Tamburan also continued the Sadas with more vigor and enthusiasm. Great scholars like Mandirta Kunju Nambudiri, Tarkika Tilakan Mandirta Kunju Nambudiri, Shabdita Tilakan Ayya Shastrigal, Sahitya Tilakan K. Ramakrishnarudi, and so many others in Kerala, and so many other scholars from other parts of India, particularly South India, used to participate in the Vidwan Sadas. Parikshit used to preside over the Sadas also on all days. The Sadas was praised in those times, both in the time of Rama Varma, His Highness Rama Varma, and in the time of Parikshit Tamburan. The Sadas was praised by the scholars as the moon shining with the groups of stars glittering around him. Pandita Uddu Parivrita Rajya Samanam. Pandita Uddu Parivrita Rajya Samanam. Pandita Uddu, the scholars like stars, and the king like moon, surrounded by the glittering stars who are scholars. The word in Sanskrit Rajya has both the meanings king and Chandra, moon. Panditodu Parivrita Rajya Samana. Such was the glory of the Shastra Sadas that was taking place at that time. The Sadas, with all its glory, is even now conducted in the college for 3 days in the last week of December, and with the present group of teachers headed by principal and other teachers. They are conducting the Sadas still now, continuing. And as I have stated in the beginning, myself has the opportunity to take part in the Sadas for the last 15 years, almost continuously, from my pre-degree to up to the present day. And we used to coach many students and take them to the Sadas, and their presentation will be there, and many of that such students from Pattambi and other institutions, they are now good scholars and teachers in Tripura Science College, taking part in the sadhas and organizing the sadhas, which is a matter of great delight. So this is a very important. In Kerala, there was a sadhas of equal importance centered at Trivandrum, Navaratri Vidwal Sadhas. In Navaratra days, it was conducted, but it ceased to be, it was stopped due to many reasons. And now, at present, teachers of Sanskrit College Trivandrum, they are trying to renovate it. And so, only Tripunatra, Sadhas of Tripunatra Sanskrit College is the only traditional Sadhas that was continuously keeping the Shastra tradition for many years, from the time of His Highness Ramavarma to the present day. So, this is a very peculiar feature which was started by Ramavarma, His Highness Ramavarma, and continued by Parikshit Tamburan, and which is continuing even now. Another unique feature of the Sanskrit tradition of Tripunatra is the wealth of manuscripts and transcripts preserved in the college related to different works in the field of all Shastras. This is also actually a continuation of the tradition started by the royal patronage, His Highness Ramavarma, which is being preserved and continued even now. Manuscripts of rare works are preserved in the Manuscript Library in Government Sanskrit College, Tripunatra, related to various fields of Sanskrit learning like Veda, Mahabharata, Bhagavata, Puranas, Ramayana, Bhagavad Gita, Vedanta, Vyakarana, Nyaya, Vaidya, Vishavaidya, Yodisha, Shilpa, Dharma Shastra, Tantra, Nadaga, Kavya, Alangara Shastra, Artha Shastra, Sangeeta Shastra, and Koshas. You see, it is a very important fact that Tripunatra can be considered as the second most important manuscript depository in Kerala. First, of course, was to Trivandrum, because Trivandrum Manuscript Library has more manuscripts than that of Tripunatra, and more publications have come from there. But equal importance is to the manuscript depository of Tripunatra, and their scholars, many scholars from other parts of India and from foreign countries, they come to Kerala for locating the manuscripts. Sanskrit scholars come to Kerala for locating the manuscripts for their editions and studies. They visit Trivandrum Oriental Manuscript Library as well as Tripunatra Manuscript Library. Professor Ashok Akhlujikar, many scholars, they are depending on Tripunatra Manuscript Library even now for editing and publishing and research in Sanskrit areas. So, at the present, the whole list, there is the full list of manuscripts of Manuscript Library of Tripunatra, which was prepared systematically by Professor Ramachandra Iyer. There is all record there, and if you go through the records, you can understand that it was Professor Ramachandra Iyer who took charge as the first principal when the college was affiliated to the Kerala University. He took efforts to systematically arrange the manuscripts, list them, and number them. So that list is now available in the website, in the site of National Manuscript Mission, NMM, National Manuscript Mission of IGNCA, Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, New Delhi. So, this is a very important aspect of a very important factor regarding the Sanskrit tradition of Tripundra. Now, Professor Varkedi was giving his opinion that Tripundra Sanskrit College should begin a web journal, and each and every student, sorry, teacher of the college should locate one manuscript and give a description of the manuscript in one or two pages in each journal. And I would suggest one more point, and I have suggested that earlier before. There are so many manuscripts in Tripundra treasure, Tripundra manuscript library, which are not even now identified, located, edited, published. So each and every young teacher can take one manuscript and work on it and publish it, either small manuscript or large manuscript, and work on it and publish it with the determination that he or she will do it within 2 years. Take a manuscript and work on it and publish it within 2 years at least. So if such a kind of work is awaiting for the manuscripts in Tripundra also, which is equally awaiting for the manuscripts of Trivandrum also. So this is a very important aspect of the Sanskrit tradition of Tripundra. Many publications have already come based on the manuscripts of Tripundra. Nadangusha, the critic on Kudiyattam, famous Vengivyakya, commentary on Subhadradharanjaya and Tavari Samvarana, commentaries on Anjana, commentaries Anjana, and the commentary of Dasharathi on Dhunyaloka Lochana, commentaries of Sahadeva Tilakan K. Ramakrishna Reddy, etc., are some important works published using the manuscripts of Tripundra library. Now, many other valuable manuscripts are also preserved there. So many manuscripts are even now not located, and scholars can work on that. One example is Sanskrit Kathakali works of Veera Kerala Varma of Kochi. Sanskrit Kathakali works, Veera Kerala Varma of Kochi. Kochi was a great scholar in the tradition before Rajarshi Rama Varma, one or two ancestrally before. And this Kerala Varma, Veera Kerala Varma was a great scholar. He was converted to Madhva order later, which created so many problems there. And it is said that he has written more than 100 Sanskrit Kathakali works. 100 Sanskrit Kathakali, 100 Kathakali works in pure Sanskrit. And there is a manuscript in Tripundra still where there are about 50 Kathakali works in Sanskrit written by Kerala Varma. A huge manuscript, a big manuscript. I have edited one or two Kathakali works from that, and it was published from National Manuscript Mission, IGNCA, New Delhi. So then, very important, all of you know Krishnapadi commentary of Raghavananda on Bhagavata. So many commentaries, so many unpublished works, unknown works are there in the manuscript collection of Tripundra. Now I understand that many scholars are doing many skandhas of Krishnapadi for their PhD work. It is welcome. So all these, the wealth of manuscripts is also a unique feature of the Tripundra Sanskrit tradition, for which we are very much indebted to the founder Rajarshi Rama Varma. Rajarshi Rama as a scholar, as a date who was promoting Sanskrit, but Rajarshi Ramavarma, he is famous not only as a scholar, poet, and the patron of Sanskrit and its shastras, but he is also remembered with gratitude by the posterity as a benevolent administrator and as an architect of modern Kochi. Actually speaking, history presents him as the architect of modern Kochi. When he ascended the throne, the state was in an undeveloped stage. Under the efficient divans, like Mr. the first divans, like Sri P. Rajagopalachari, Pattabhirama Rao, and Albin Banerjee, he strengthened his administration. He strengthened his secretariat. Rules of taxation were made strict. The law and order system was freed from corruptions. He promoted education in all ways to all in the state. The starting of Maharaja's College, Ernakulam, starting of the Ayurveda College, Tripunathra, so many new innovative programs he started for the benefit of the state and the people. He promoted education in all ways to all in the state. The most important work he connected to him, recorded in the history, is the construction and completion of the Shornur-Ernakulam railway line, which was a major achievement of Rajarshi Ramavarma. Shornur-Ernakulam railway line was constructed and completed in his time. It is said that during the work, the funds for the work became insufficient, and Ramavarma, His Highness, decided to sell 6 gold caparisons kept in the Purnatra Isha built temple out of 7. For the Usava there, 7 elephants were there. For them, the caparisons, 7 caparisons were with full gold, were kept there in the treasury of the temple. Ramavarma, His Highness, decided to sell this for 6 caparisons, gold caparisons, the money of which he decided to utilize for the construction and completion of the Shornur Kochi railway line. So, which was 6 gold caparisons kept in the Purnatra Isha temple out of 7, which were used for decorating the elephants for the temple festivals. When the Orthodox group came forward with protest, Rajarshi told them firmly that Purnatra Isha would like to travel his subjects, his people, the people in the state, in train conveniently, more than decorating the elephants with them. This was the comment of Rajarshi Ramavarma, like the comment he had when this college was started and a huge amount of money was invested and a protest came for that. This was the determination and dedication of the king for the causes of the common citizens of his state, as well as for the cause of the Sanskrit education also. And as everyone knows, and recorded in history, he abandoned his kingship, his rule, with his own wish before completing his term. And it was a very important historical epoch in the history of Kochi itself. So, that great scholar, great king, promoter of Sanskrit, is a great man, and the college continuing now founded by him has so many stages of development in positive way, which is continuing even now, and it will continue even in the future with more vigor and enthusiasm. There is no doubt, because we have, all of us have, his grace and his blessings. Now I will conclude this small presentation with a slogan with the words of Parikshit Tamburan about Rajarshi Ramavarma, remembering his glory and reputation. Yena amathi dhiya kushagra samaya shastrambhurashir nave yena bhojicha madhyame vasumati yatnena samlalita yena atyaji vivaschita vayasi tad rajyam tatha paschime dishtya rajati soyam achyutapadanyastandaratma nrpa. The king, His Highness Rajarshi Ramavarma, in his youthful days, Nave Vayasi, in his youthful days, Dhiya Kushagra Samaya Shastram Budhihi Amathi, with his deep intellect, he churned the ocean of the Shastras, which can be churned with very pointed intellect only, deep intellect only. Yena amathi kushagra samaya shastrambudhi shastramburashihi dhiya amathi nave, in his youthful days. Yena abhojicha madhyame, in the middle ages of his life, the middle part of his life, he ruled the stage. He enjoyed the ruling of the stage and protected his subjects and developed his kingdom as far as he could do in the middle ages. Then yena atyaji ivaschita, the great scholar, knowing the real end of the life, the absoluteness of the universe, the real end, what is the real end, the real culmination of the life, knowing everything, vipaschita, scholarly thinking all these things, paschime, in the third stage of his life, what did he do? Yena atyaji tadrajyam, he himself abandoned the sovereignty with his own wish. Such a great king, His Highness Ramavarma, Rajarshi Ramavarma, Dishtya Rajasi Soyam, Achyuta Padanyastandaratma Nrpa. So great is the, was the king and his contribution, and I salute before the great personality, and I conclude this thanking all of you, all the organizers, my friends, dear friends and lovers of Sanskrit, requesting to take a note, all of us, not myself or not one among you, all of us together, to proceed with the dedicated hard work of promoting Sanskrit, learning Sanskrit education in our country. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your valuable presentation, and you have already gone through a history of our college and presented it in a very detailed manner. I think if there are any person to make any clarification, need any clarification on the remarks made by Dr. C. M. Nilandan, sir, you may ask the question or make any additions to the paper already presented. You can have the time for at least 5 minutes are there to conclude the session.
I concluded before 5 minutes because yes, yes, I it is time.
If anyone want to add something or need any clarification, they may ask or give addition to the presentation.
They should do, I request.
I think everyone is satisfied with the presentation, and now it is the time to go to another presentation. The Amba Kulkarni, madam, is the in the presentation of the madam will be coordinated by Dr. Sarida KV, the assistant professor English, and I welcome the madam to introduce madam and to coordinate the session.
Very good morning, all of you. Now, we have reached the last session of the two-day national webinar on Sanskrit in Higher Education, Possibilities and Challenges. I think these 2 days have been very fruitful for all the aspirants of Sanskrit language and linguistics. I'm sure that this session also would be very enriching for all of us, as we have Dr. Amba Kulkarni as our resource person. She is professor, Department of Sanskrit Studies, University of Hyderabad. She is an eminent scholar and a well-known figure in the field of Sanskrit studies. Her field of interest include computational linguistics, NLP, machine translation, corpus linguistics, to name a few. She has to her credit so many journal publications and presentations. She has written a number of books in connection with linguistics. She has carried out many projects and collaborations and has contributed to develop websites in connection with the language processing. I think I have touched upon only a few of her achievements due to time limit, but we all know that she is the most apt person to speak on the scope of information technology in Sanskrit research, which is the topic of this session. And on behalf of everyone who are participating in this program, and on behalf of the IQC of Government Sanskrit College, I extend you, ma'am, a very warm welcome. Thank you.
Namaskar. Namo Namaha. So, am I audible? Is it, the voice is fine? The volume?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this workshop, 2 days workshop, where eminent scholars like Professor Gangadharan Nair, whom I see here, and Professor Vakhedi, just now I heard Professor Nilakantham, and other dignitaries were there. So, it's my really an honor to be part of this webinar. I already spoke with the organizer regarding what I would be more interested in today. In fact, instead of just giving a talk, I would like to have it a dialogue. See, what is happening is with this Zoom meetings, Google meetings, etc., there is very less dialogue and more monologue is there. I would prefer it to be a kind of dialogue. So I will start with something with the title, the topic which has been suggested for me. I am told that already a course on computational linguistics and natural language processing is being floated in this college, Sanskrit College, for the students. And there are several teachers who are interested in this topic. So instead of just telling you again some of the things which you might be knowing already, I will be interested in having a dialogue with you. So keep your questions ready. Meanwhile, I will just set the floor. So the topic is the role of information technology for Sanskrit studies. Now, when we say technology, I'm sorry, there are some vendors which are outside speaking. I'm not in my office today, being a holiday, I'm at home. Okay, so the technology, any technology for that matter, requires science. Okay, it is based on science. Of course, some of the technologies, they get evolved and then later on the science gets developed. But most of the times, it is the science which gives rise to technology. Now, the technology what we are talking about is the information technology. Earlier, there was another kind of technology which all of us were familiar with, and that was the revolution, industrial revolution, which took place, where energies were being converted from one form to the other. So the energy in water getting converted into electricity. Now we have the solar energy, which is being converted to electricity, and so on. That was another kind of technology. Now the technology which we are dealing with is the computational technology, computer technology. And of course, we have the internet. Web is there, World Wide Web is there. So how this technology is different from the other technologies? Essentially, this technology deals with languages. Now, languages and communication. Now you may say, we used telephones also earlier for communication. We used radio for communication. We used television for communication. Communication through language. But then there is a difference between the way we use that communication, these technologies for communication, and the way we are using now the computer technology for communication. What is the difference? The difference is when we use radio, telephone, television, etc., we were just transmitting the electromagnetic waves. That's it. We were not processing them. We were not looking at what is the varna there, what is the word, what is the sentence, what is the meaning of the sentence, and so on. Okay, so just I speak, the speech sound gets converted to electromagnetic waves, that gets transmitted and you hear it, you listen it, that's it. But now with computers, what is happening is something different. We are processing the language. What does it mean? When we write something, when we write a message, say for example on Facebook, you might have seen that some advertisements may get popped up. Or let us take the example of email. When you send emails to your friends, in some email, like Yahoo, etc., Yahoo, Hotmail, etc., their advertisements pop up. Now, these advertisements, if you have seen, noticed, they are very much related to what you had written earlier. Okay? So, what is happening is, this email program, the software which handles the email, which transmits the emails, etc., which transfers the messages from one person to another. The software looks at the content, okay, and processes that content. You might have seen, suppose you have booked some ticket, okay, say by Indian Railways or by a flight ticket. Then Google automatically gives you an intimation saying that you have your journey at this point. Just now when I was setting up this Google Meet, just 5 minutes back, I got a message from my computer saying that your meeting is now going to start. Please join in. Now, how does it know that my meeting is going to start? Because I had received a message from your group saying that meeting is at this time and please join at 11:45. So when I got that message, machine looked at that message and processed it, and it also set up the alarm. Okay, so see how intelligent the machines are becoming and how they are processing the language. Okay, so it looks at the language, it looks at the message and tries to take the decision, tries to set up the alarm and all these things. So essentially with computers now what is happening is the information is getting processed. Okay, so how to process the information? For this we need a science, and this science is in our shastras, and there it becomes very relevant for us to learn Sanskrit shastras. All these various shastras, Vyakarana, Nyaya and Mimamsa, all these, even Alankara Shastra, Sahitya Shastra, they deal with how you communicate with the other person through a language string. Okay. How this communication takes place? Communication at various levels. It's not just information which we are passing. We pass the emotions, we express emotions through them. So how they are being passed. So all this science is there in Indian shastras. Okay. So the relevance of our shastras for information technology is there. And now this information technology is opening up a good opportunity for us to use these shastras to develop these tools, etc. So this is how we can take benefit of the current scenario, current information technology era, to further our shastras. So these shastras were developed well 2,000, 3,000 years ago, or even more than that. Right from the Vedic period, we have the discussions on various aspects of language, like the Pratishakhyas are there, you have the Nirukta, you have then Vyakarana and various other things. So all these, and of course Mimamsa is there, Purva Mimamsa, all these actually are very much relevant for the information technology. So I would say information technology is giving us an opportunity to show the relevance of our shastras. So instead of just learning computer programming and other things, I would say let us get strong in our shastras and tell the world how these shastras are useful for doing this. For example, one of the things what they do is called sentiment analysis. Now, what is sentiment analysis? This is useful for the advertisement. Okay. What they do is, suppose you have purchased something from the Amazon. Then, not all, but some of those who purchase something will give their feedback. Okay. Now, when that feedback is read by the machine, by the software, what the software does is tries to look at what is, whether the feedback is positive or negative. How many of them have given positive feedback, how many of them have given negative feedback, and so on. So next time, suppose somebody wants to purchase that, then machine says, oh, instead of this, you go for this one. This item is better than this one. Okay? And it also shows the comparison and all these things. How does it do? It does it through the sentiment analysis. So it looks at the text and then analyzes it from various using looking at various adjectives that are used, etc., and then what it is being said. So what is the tatparya of this feedback that it tries to get through various means? And we already have theories to decide the tatparya. Now what we need to do is, in the current context, we need to show, we need to contextualize our theories. That means, instead of just looking at the same examples which have been discussed all these days, instead of that, let us try to apply it to certain problems that we face. One of the problems that we face is we get spam mails. Can we decide whether a mail is spam or not by looking at the content? Okay? And if a human being can decide, then how to tell machine to decide whether something is spam or not? So such applications then we can discuss. So of course, it is not necessary that we build the applications. We can just come up with some solutions, and these solutions then can be used by others to for applications, etc. See, the computer scientists, they do not know much about the language processing. They try to guess and they try to find their own solutions, but in our shastras already solutions are there. So what we need to do is look at the contemporary problems and see if we can provide solutions to them. Okay, so this is what we need to do. So shall I invite questions now, or should I? I think I am more interested in having a dialogue rather than monologue. So shall we go for question answer?
I have already told the participants to prepare for questions, and they have made some preparations, and I think they can.
So they will ask. If you start asking questions, that would be great, actually.
Good.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Ma'am, now we are teaching NLP, and we have a lot of doubts regarding the subject. So, ma'am, can you say what is? Can you explain the parser and what is parser and different kinds of parsers and constraint parser? Correct definition and all these things of these are not available in the text that we have prescribed. So,
Good question. See, parsing means analysis. Okay. Now, this parsing can be analysis at word level or analysis at sentence level. Typically, when you use the word parser is used for analysis at sentence level. Now, what is meant by sentence level analysis? So, suppose you have a sentence, Ramo Vanam Gacchati. Then the sentence level analysis is Rama Kartruka Vana Karmaka Gamana Kriya Bhavati. Okay? So Rama is the Karta and Vana is the Karma. This analysis is called the parse of a sentence. Okay? Now this parse is called dependency parsing. Okay? There are two words. One is dependency and the other one is constituency.
Yes.
Okay. Now, dependency means the vibhakti of vana in vana.
Okay.
This depends on gacchati. Okay.
Yes.
If gacchati gamyate is there,
yes,
it would have been su. It would have been su if gamyate is there. Okay. This vibhakti is governed by or decided by the verb.
Yes.
So it depends on the verb, the thing part of it. Okay?
Yes.
So this analysis is called dependency analysis.
Okay? Yes. Okay.
Now let us take another example. example of a compound. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Suppose we have tapasvadhyaya niratam.
Yes.
Okay. Now there are three words: tapas, swadhyaya, and niratam. The three components are there. Okay. They are not padas. They are purva pada, tapas, madhyam pada is. There are three components, ghatakas of this compound of the samasta pada tapasvadhyaya niratam. Now, how do you know what is the relation between them? So when there are three padas, whether to group tapas and swadhyaya together first, or swadhyaya and niratam first. Okay, so the in tapas swadhyaya niratam, the meaning is tapascha swadhyayascha tapasvadhyayo tam niratam tapasvadhyaya niratam. See, I will be wrong in some vibhakti, etc.
No, tapas
niratam. Tasmin niratam, tam, not tam. Tasmin niratam, saptami is there, right? So, in tapasvadhyaya niratam, there are three components and we need to group tapas and swadhyaya first and then niratam is to be added. But it is possible that there might be some other compound where second and third word are to be added first and then add the first one. This is also possible in some compounds. I don't remember a word immediately. I want three components. Three components where, or let us take Dvandva, where you have Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata. Now, there all the three are to be grouped together. You cannot say Rama and Lakshmana, I will group together and then I will add Bharata. No, we need to take all of them together, Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, all three are together. So, in constituency analysis, what we do is how to group the words together. And after grouping the words together, we are not seeing the Karaka Sambandha, but here what we see is what type of compound it is. Whether it is Tatpurusha, Bahuvrihi, or Karmadharaya or Dvandva, etc. Okay? So, here different kind of analysis is needed to understand compounds. This is called constituency analysis. Okay? So, and this is how they analyze English-like languages also. So, for example, in English, if you have a sentence like the boy went home, then the boy should be grouped together first. Then they will say the boy is NP and went home is a verb phrase, and a noun phrase and verb phrase together form a sentence. This is how they analyze. So essentially, in constituency analysis, constituency means ghataka. Okay. So, constituency analysis means how the ghatakas are joined together to get a sentence. This is constituency analysis. There, you are not looking at the karaka sambandha. When you look at the karaka sambandha, that is a dependency analysis. Okay? Is it clear?
What about constraint, Pastor? Okay.
Okay, I will come to that. So the next thing is the parser that we now Ramaha Vanam Gachati. This is the sentence. So here we need to analyze this sentence. I will take instead of Ramaha Vanam Gachati, I will take Yanam Vanam Gachati. Okay. So or let me take Ramaha Vanam Gachati itself. Now in Ramaha Vanam Gachati, Ramaha. This word has, this pada has two analysis. One, Rama Pullinga Prathama Ekavachanam. And another analysis is Rama ityatra Ramaha ityatra Radhatu vartate. Then you have the Prathama Purusha. उत्तम पुरुष बहुवचने वयम रामः सो वयम ब्राह्मणाय धनम रामः सो सच सेंटेंस इज पॉसिबल सो नाउ वी नीड टू डिसाइड In the sentence Ramaha Vanam Gacchati, is this Ramaha a verb or a noun? Whether it is Subanta or Diganta.
Yes.
Then in Vanam, we need to decide whether it is Prathama Ekavachanam or Dvitiya Ekavachanam. Okay. And in Gacchati, we need to decide whether it is Latlakara or Saptami Ekavachanam Shatranta. Pullinga or Napunsakalinga. Okay? So now, how do you decide this? So, let us take Ramaha as the verb, Tiganta. Suppose Ramaha is Tiganta.
Oh, sentence become meaningless.
Meaningless. Why?
Yes.
Why it is meaningless?
Because the verb is not...
गच्छति तत्र गच्छति सप्तमी एकवचनम् अपि स्यात्
योग्यता नास्ति
हां सो हियर व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इज इफ वी टेक गच्छति सप्तमी एकवचनम् देन वी एक्सपेक्ट सम अदर वर्ड इन सप्तमी सती सप्तमी सी ओनली इन सती सप्तमी गच्छति कैन बी इन सप्तमी एकवचनम् ओके Like Rame Vanam Gacchati Sati Sita Anusarati, something like that. So Rame and Gacchati, two words are there. Then we can say Gacchati is a Shatru Pratyaya, Shatranta. While Rama is going, Sita is following her, him. So, but here there is no other word in Saptami. We have Ramaha, Vanam and Gacchati. So, Gacchati cannot be in Saptami, Ekavachanam. Okay. Now, Gacchati had three analysis. One, Latlakara. Second, Saptami Ekavachanam Pullinga. Third, Saptami Ekavachanam Napunsakalinga. Now, Saptami Ekavachanam Pullinga Napunsakalinga are out of way. They are not there. So, Gacchati here is the verb. So, first we have decided Ramaha is not a verb here. But Gacchati is the Tiganta. Okay. Now, once we know Gacchati is the Tiganta, what are its akankshas? What are its expectancies? Gacchati, Gamanakriya is there. In Gamanakriya, there are two expectancies. Who is going? Kaha Gacchati, Kutra Gacchati. Okay. So, Kaha Gacchati, this should be in Prathama. And Kutra Gacchati, it should be in Dvitiya Vibhakti. Okay? So, Vanam should be in Dvitiya. Okay? Now, why Vanam is not in Prathama? Because if we take Vanam in Prathama, there is no other word which is in Dvitiya. Okay? So, Ramaha cannot be Karma. Ramaha is in Prathama Vibhakti. So, it should be Karta and Vana should be Karma. So, there are these conditions. What kind of conditions are there? If there is an expectancy, it should be satisfied. Okay? So, if there is an expectancy of karta, karma, etc., it should be satisfied. Then, so this is the akanksha. Then there should be yogyata. Okay? And sannidhi also should be there. So, they are putting constraints. Constraints means badhaka. They are putting some what is
called? Possibilities. Possibilities?
No, not possibilities. Constraint is limitations. You are putting some restrictions, not limitations. Restrictions. Constraints are restrictions.
Okay.
So, you are putting some restrictions. And what these restrictions are, there should be akanksha, there should be yogyata. These are the restrictions. Okay.
To find out the actual meaning, you are putting some kind of restrictions. So,
yes. Okay. And these constraints we got from our Shabdabuddha theories only. Our Shabdabuddha theories tell us that akanksha is one constraint, then yogyata is another constraint. Let me take another example. Sundaram yanam gacchati. Let us take this one. Sundaram yanam gacchati. Or let me take first yanam vanam gacchati. Now in yanam vanam gacchati, yanam is in prathama and dvitiya. Vanam is also in prathama and dvitiya. Now we need to know which one is the karta and which is the karma. How do we know this? Yogyata.
Sir, as far as Sanskrit is concerned, it is very easy for them. So, this is for the machine.
You are
thinking on machine. So, yes.
Okay. I'm looking at it. See, this is how we need to think of. And our ancestors also have thought objectively. They are not putting any subjective constraint there. Okay? Objectively, that's why they say yogyata should be there. Now, yanam vanam gacchati. Atra vane yogyata nasti gamana kriya kartrutvasya yogyata nasti. Parantu yane gamana kriyayaha kartrutvasya yogyata vartate. Okay? So, in yanam vanam gacchati, we need to take yana as the karta and vana as the karma. Okay, now suppose sundaram yanam gacchati is the sentence. Now, can I say, what tells me that sundara is the visheshanam? Okay. See, in yanam vanam gacchati, we do not say yana is the visheshana of vana or vana is the visheshana of yana. But in sundaram yanam, we say sundara is the visheshana of yanam. Why? Okay. So here, we need to look at the vaisheshika dravya padartha, sapta padartha vartate kalu. Sapta padartha, the dravya guna kriya, samavaya, samanya, vishesha, and abhava. These are the sapta padarthas. So, now sundara. And it's yana and vana, both of them are dravyas. Okay? Can one dravya be a visheshana of another dravya? See, guna can be visheshana.
True, very true.
So, see, we have, all our ancestors have told everything to us. We need to think over it, okay? And connect all these things. So, already we have this dravya guna vibhaga. So, yana and vana, both of them are dravyas. So, they cannot be good, they cannot be visheshanas of each other. But, sundaram yanam. Now, sundara is a guna. And therefore, it can be a visheshana. Okay? And Panini uses the word guna vachana. So, you can say sundaram gacchati. Instead of sundaram yanam gacchati, sundaram gacchati, you can say. Shuklaha dhavati. Okay? So, these are called guna vachanas. So, we need to understand what is this guna vachana. And once we develop this theory further, this will be useful for the computer scientists, computational linguists. Okay? So, I would say, instead of concentrating on computer programming, etc., why not we develop our theories further so that they become contextual, they become relevant in the present context. Okay? And not only for Sanskrit, this should be applicable to other languages also. Right? Once we know guna or visheshana, what is visheshana, then even for Malayalam, for Telugu, for Marathi, the same thing will be applicable. Right? Okay. So, is this clear, madam? Please put on your bike.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. Thank you. What about digital passing? How will it differ from NLP?
Digital passing? No, I think
the difference between digital passing and NLP.
No, there is no digital passing as such. You might be thinking of machine learning.
No, ma'am. The syllabus given by them says so. So I can't see anything regarding this.
No, you see, this
digital passing tools. Digital passing tools and difference between. I'm sorry. Difference between NLP and computational linguistics. And so now you told about passing. So what is the difference between passing and digital passing? Is there any?
Okay, fine. See, actually, parsing. If you do it manually, it is manual parsing. If we do it through computer, it is digital parsing. Or through computers, we are parsing. And in Samsarthani, if you go to Anusarakam Russian translation system, there the parser is available. Okay, so you can give sentence to the machine, and machine can show you the parse. Okay, so it will show what is the Karaka analysis, etc.
Okay,
this is for Sanskrit. If you want for other languages, say for example, for English, there is Stanford parser available. Okay, Stanford University has developed a parser. Then Carnegie Mellon University has developed a parser. So these parsers are available online. You can go to their website and give an English sentence, and you will get the parse tree. Parse structure. So what is the vishesh, mukhya vishesha, what are the visheshanas, what is the sambandha, what is the karta, karma, etc. They don't use the word karta, karma, etc. They will use subject, object, such relations, but they provide this kind of analysis. Okay, so this is the digital parsing. Now the question is, what is the difference between NLP, natural language processing, and computational linguistics? Okay. Now, natural language processing, the mukhya vishesha is processing, kriya. Okay. Natural language, that is languages which we speak. Now, let me explain what is a natural language versus an artificial language. Artificial language is the language which is designed specifically, formally, such as computer programming language, like Java or Python. These are all programming languages which are artificial. In Sanskrit also, we have a artificial language, do you know? It is the language of Navya Nyaya. Okay, so the language of Navya Nyaya is such as Samavaya Sambandha Vachinna Gandhatva Vachinna Gandhanishta Adheyata Nirupita Adhikaranata Vati Prithvi. Now, a common man who knows Sanskrit will not understand this. Okay, so this is an artificial language. Okay, now natural language processing is processing of natural languages. Okay, now what is meant by processing of natural languages? What are the things involved? First thing is how to decide where a sentence is over and where next sentence starts. In Yajurveda, they discuss this. How to decide the sentence boundaries. And then they say, artha ikatva ekam vakyam sakamsham chet vibhage syat. So, the Mimamsakas also had this problem. How to decide one mantra is over and another mantra starts? Because we do this Sanhita Patha. In Sanhita Patha, we do not know where to break, where the one sentence is over, one mantra is over. Similarly, in Bhagavad Gita shlokas, if we look at, sometimes one shloka can have two sentences. Or sometimes two or three shlokas together give you one sentence. Okay? Sorry, there is some screen is coming up.
Mahashaya,
Nilandan sir, present in Nilandan sir. Nilandan sir. Sir, the screen share on.
Hello.
Hello, Nilandan sir.
Hello, Nilakantan sir. Your screen is being shared. Will you please stop it? Hello, sir. By mistake.
Okay, okay, okay. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, then. Okay. Now is it? Yeah, it's fine. Hello, Nilakantan sir. There is some problem from your side. Hello. Hello. Okay, I will continue. Okay, there is this disturbance. Something is coming on the screen, which is being disturbed. I'm getting
maybe
disturbed.
Maybe unknowingly.
Unknowingly it is happening. Okay, so coming to this NLP and computational linguistics. So as I said, we have natural language processing. These three words are there. Processing means we do some prakriya on it. So what kind of prakriya? Suppose a sentence is given, then we need to decide where, what are the words in it. So pada vibhaga, that is one kind of processing. Then when suppose you have Rama Vanam Gacchati. Now in Rama Vanam Gacchati, Ramaha is one pada. Then Vanam is another pada. Gacchati is third pada. This pada vibhaga we need to do. Okay? So this is one task. Suppose you have some compounds such as Tapasvadhyaya Niratam itself or Rameshwara, then we need to do the analysis of this compound word. That is also a processing. Or processing also involves analysis at sentential level. So various kinds of processings are possible. Now, what is computational linguistics? The process versus linguistics. In linguistics, the word is Bhasha Shastra. So linguistics is mainly a science, okay? And in computational linguistics, we study the language aspect of it. In natural language processing, more focus is on developing a system, okay? Developing a computational model, developing a software, that is there in natural language processing. But in computational linguistics, the main focus is on the analysis from language point of view. So how these two terms came into existence? What happened is, some 40, 50 years ago, when they were working on languages, there were language persons, that is linguists, who were working on computational processing, and there were engineers, computer scientists, who were also working on these systems. The linguists who were working, they were looking at how to do it computationally, and the engineers were trying to also develop the systems, but they were more interested in the how to make the process faster, how to implement the system, how to write the program efficiently, and so on. So in natural language processing, more emphasis is on the engineering aspect. Whereas in computational linguistics, the more focus is on the linguistic aspect of it. Of course, nowadays, a computational linguist knows as much engineering as a NLP person knows the linguistic issues. Okay, so this difference is getting reduced, but some 20-30 years ago, this difference was there. Okay, have I answered the question?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. I understand. Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
Any other question?
Madam, will you please explain what is text corpora and corpus linguistics?
Okay. So, corpora is a plural of corpus. Text corpora means you have several texts. Corpus is the body. Okay. So, body of texts. That means lot many texts. So that is text corpora. So for example, if you go to various websites like Wikipedia, Wikipedia has a text corpus. Okay.
Okay.
It has several texts on several topics, etc. So it has a text. There is a text corpora in the form of Wikipedia. Similarly. We had SanskritNet project and all Sanskrit texts were there. That was again another corpus. So there were several such websites where you have different corpora available, which is related to Sanskrit. Similarly for other languages, for Greek, for English, for Malayalam, for Marathi, for Telugu, there are corpora available. Now, what is corpus linguistics? A very important question. Now, corpus linguistics, Bhasha Shastra, and corpus linguistics is that Bhasha Shastra, that science which uses corpus for its study. Okay. So, for example, now one example of corpus linguistics I will tell you. Suppose we collect all the krutis of Kalidasa, okay, and we do some stylistic study of it. Now, what kind of stylistic study? We see how many kinds of how many tadditas Kalidasa has used, how many upamas Kalidasa has used, okay, whether Kalidasa has used Karmani Prayoga more or Kartari Prayoga more. All this study we can do for any text. Similarly for Bhagavad Gita. Which vibhaktis are used more? Which verbs are used more? What kind of visheshanas are there? And then what kind of chanda is used all over Bhagavad Gita? These kind of studies are related to corpus linguistics.
Critical and analytical study, isn't it?
This is stylistic analysis, critical analysis, you may call by various names. Okay?
Okay.
And already we were aware of all such things we were doing. For example, Bhasa Chakra, that we could guess that all those 13 krutis are by Bhasa by looking at the similarity between these texts, right? We knew of Swapna Vasavadatta, but we didn't know that all others are krutis of Bhasa. Bhasa Nataka Chakra I am referring to. So, how do we came to know about it, or how do we decide it? Based on the stylistic analysis. And now computers can help us in doing the stylistic analysis. Okay. Even this corpus analysis, corpus linguistics, will also help us in deciding the chronology of various texts. Okay?
Okay.
Philological studies and other things. Okay? And we should take up such studies. And for this, very little of computer programming is needed. What is more needed is the Bhasha Shastra. Okay?
Okay.
Any other question?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Any other question? It was a good question. Both the questions, Madam Jyotsna as well as Uday ji, both the questions were very good. Yes. Any other question?
regarding compound analysis, can you explain? Compound generator, yes.
Compound generator is different and compound analysis is different.
Compound analyzer and compound generator, what is the difference between these two?
Okay, so first let us try to understand the difference between analysis and generation. Analysis is the vishleshana. Generation is samshleshana. Vishleshana and samshleshana. Samshleshana means you are forming a compound. Ramanas Purushasu is given.
Yes, we understand.
That is the generation process. And for generation process, Panini has given complete rules. That how the Vibhakti Lopa takes place, then how to give how to decide which one will come first and which word will come later, how to join them, what are the Sandhi rules and so on. Similarly, for generation of sentence, Panini has given the rules, which Vibhakti is to be assigned for which Karakas and so on. Now, analysis is a reverse process, okay? Reverse of generation. So now suppose Raja Purusha is given. We need to understand what kind of compound it is, okay? Now, in compound analysis, what are the steps that are involved? So I will take again the same example, Tapasvadhyaya Niratam. So first step is we need to know which are the components. Tapas is one component, Svadhyaya is another, and Niratam is third one. So this is what first we need to know. Once we know that these are the components, next thing we should know how to combine them. Which words to combine with which one? That is constituency analysis. So first one is segmentation. Padachcheda. Then you need to decide which two components has samarthya. Okay? So samarthya nirdharanam is the second step. Then third step is we need to know what type of compound it is. Okay? So tapas and svadhyaya, that is karmadharayam. Or dvandva. What is it? Dvandva. Dvandva, that is dvandva. So we need to decide what type of compound it is. Then niratam, when niratam comes, then it is saptami tatpurusha. So this is what we need to know. So this is the deciding the meaning of the compound. When we are saying what type of compound, by that I mean we are deciding the meaning. Okay. Once we know saptami tatpurusha, we know what is the meaning. Once we know it is dvandva, we know what is the meaning. Okay? Then we need to give the vigraha vakya so that the other person understands it. So these are the four steps that are involved in compound analysis. Okay? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Any other question?
Madam.
Yes.
Madam, structure of a sentence is a modified-modifier structure. There is four or more kinds of modified-modifier structure. This structure, how it is useful in NLP?
No, will you please repeat the question?
Structure of a sentence, it contains modified and modifier. Modifier and modified. There is six kind of modified structure, sentence structure. This structure, how it is useful in NLP?
So what are six kinds of modified?
Modified with the adjectives, verb modified with verb, noun modified with the participle, noun modified with the adjectives, these types of sentences, sentence structure, modified structure. It is a part of language analysis. It is directly used in NLP.
See, Well, I am not aware of this noun modified by particle and all these things.
It is in our syllabus, madam. There is in our syllabus this type of language analyzer is such a question.
But this I am also not familiar with. What is it? Noun modified by noun or noun verb modified by
modified with verb.
Okay, see, I will put it this way. The modifier modified structure is vishesha visheshana bhava. Okay?
Yes.
Now, vishesha visheshana bhava can be between suppose you have Rama Kartruka Vanakarmaka Gamana Kriya, then that Gamana Kriya, for this, there are two visheshanas, Rama Kartruka and Vanakarmaka. Okay? So, this modifier is, this modified relation is between noun and a verb. Okay?
Yes.
Do you get this?
Hmm? Yes.
Because Rama is noun and Gacchati is a verb. Suppose you have Sundaraha Ramaha Vanam Gacchati or Viraha Ramaha Vanam Gacchati. Then Viraha and Ramaha, the relation between these is the Vishesha Visheshanam. Vira is the Visheshanam for Rama. So this relation is between Visheshana and Vishesha. Okay. Similarly, we can have a relation between two verbs like Gacchati Pathati Cha. Ramaha Vidyalayam Gacchati Pathati Cha. So here Gacchati and Pathati or Khadati Pibati Cha. So here the relation is between Khadati and Pibati, which is between verb and verb. But so this is modified. Okay, you can have another one. Ramaha dugdham pitva shalam gacchati. So pitva gacchati. There is a sambandha, purvakala sambandha. This is a verb modified relation. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. Any other question? No more questions? In the chat box, anything is there? Let me see. No, in chat box there is nothing. So,
hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Would you please tell any example of the NLP where the Navyanyaya language is used? One time you have told one. Another one, please.
Okay. See, this Navyanyaya is not directly used, okay, in NLP, but it is used indirectly. The technical language of Navyanyaya we use for Shabda Bodha, right? Say for example, as I said, Rama Kartruka Vana Karmaka Gamana Kriya, but we can also say Rama Nishtha Kartrutva Nirupita, Vana Nishtha Karmatva Nirupita, Nirupita or Nirupaka, I have to see, Nirupika. Gaman, Vartamana, Kala Vishishta, Gamana Kriya, etc. So here we are using this Navyanyaya technical language. Now, what this Navyanyaya technical language does is it provides you unambiguous sentence structure. Okay. Once this unambiguous sentence structure is there, then that can be used for reprinting the analysis without any doubt in our mind. So this Navya Nyaya language has been used by the Navya Vyakaranas to define various karakas, etc., to give the meaning of various to give the lakshana of various terms. So this lakshana then is indirectly useful for us to design the parser, to decide whether something is karta or not. How do we decide? So we go to the lakshana, we see what the lakshana is, and we try to interpret it, and then deciding based on the akanksha, etc., we try to establish the relation. So in that way, this is useful. This is one way. Another use of Navya Nyaya, not just the technical language, but the the terms avachinna and nirupita, they are very much important to develop a system of logic. We have not yet developed this system of logic, but Professor Varkhedi had worked on it some 20 years back with Professor Vinit Chaitanya and our group. And that framework is there which needs to be implemented. So somebody who knows Navya Nyaya well, who knows computer programming very well, can implement this, and then we can have a logic. We can have a logic system based on the Navya Nyaya, and we can use it to do the inferences, anumana, etc. Right now, the system that is used for doing the anumana is based on Western logic. Okay, so Navya Nyaya can be used there for developing such a system. Okay, so this is another application which I can think of.
Okay, thank you.
Any other? I'm extremely sorry for all these disturbances which are there outside. Though I have closed all the doors, still these vendors are there and a lot of noise is there outside. Yes, any other questions, sir? Anybody else?
Madam, there is one posting in the chat box. Explain the theory. Please explain the theory of complexity.
Yeah. Okay. Please explain the complexity of NLP and theory of complexity. Okay. Fine. So, what is meant by theory of complexity? Very interesting and very important question. See, complexity means how much the system is complex. Now, what is the way? How do we measure this complexity? It's a very interesting question. So, in computer programming, there is a way to measure the complexity. And what is the way? Suppose you are given one sentence. And in that sentence, suppose there are n number of varnas, say 100 varnas are there in that sentence. And for these 100 varnas, suppose for processing of each varna, machine takes some one unit of time. Then for 100 varnas, it will take 100 units of time. If there are 1,000 varnas, it will take 1,000 units of time. So this is called linear complexity. It is directly proportional to how many varnas are there. But if it takes double the time, suppose there are 100 varnas or 10 varnas are there, it takes 100 units of time. If 100 varnas are there, it takes 10,000 units of time. Then it is square. It is taking the time which is square the number of varnas. then you say that this is analysis is taking more time, this is more complex. Okay. Now we know that when we are reading something, okay, we are reading a text, if there is sandhi, we find it a bit, we take little more time than a text which is already sandhi split. If sandhi vichedaha bhavati che, yadi sandhi vichedaha bhavati, tatra sugamaha jayate pathanam. Parantu sandhi yukta padani asti che, tatra kinchit adhikaha samayaha apekshita bhavati. So, for reading, when you have that samhita patha, you take little more time, because when you are reading, you are mentally, you are splitting them. You are trying to understand what are they. Okay, you are not just reading for the sake of reading. You are also trying to understand. So, when the when you are doing more work, the system is more complex. Similarly, in order to understand a text, see, you can read it very fast, but in order to understand, you go back and read it again and again. So it is more complex work. Similarly, in computational linguistics, just reading the text is far easier than reading a sandhi text. And so sandhi splitting, segmentation, is little more difficult. Then understanding a sentence and producing the karaka visleshanam is still more difficult. If you want to understand the sangati between various pathas, adhikarana sangati, then it is still more difficult, because at a time we need to look at complete adhikarana and try to understand it. Or if there are sarvanamas, then what this sarvanama refers to? So saha is there. Well, Ramaha gacchati, saha tatra tishtati. So what is this saha? Saha is referring to Rama. How do we know? So there we need to look at the word knowledge, understand it. So it is still more complex. So this complexity increases with various tasks. Some tasks are very simple, some tasks are complex. And this complexity is measured by computer scientists in terms of how much time it takes, or what is the relation between the time it takes and the length of the sentence in terms of varnas. So if there are X varnas, if it takes X unit of times, or some 5x, 10x units of times, then it is linear. It is very simple one. If for x units of varnas, if it takes x square time, or x cube time, so if there are 10 varnas, it takes 100 units, 100 seconds to parse it, then it is more complex. So the complexity increases with these. For the parsers, normally it is more than 3 times. So if there are 10 varnas, then the time needed will be 10 cube, that is 1000 seconds, or even more than that. Okay, so this is how the complexity is measured. Have I answered the question?
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
No, I think there are no more doubts from the part of the participants. Now it is a time for saying a lot of thanks for the session and the whole webinar program. Now I invite Sri Jayaprakash sir, our vice principal, to say the lot of thanks to the session. Jayaprakash sir, please.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Our honorable chief guest, respected principal, invited chief guests, teachers, and my dear students and research colleagues. Can you hear, sir? Ajit, sir?
Yes, yes, yes.
First of all, I would like to thank the principal, Shobha teacher, in this occasion. You gave me an opportunity to speak on this auspicious foundation day of our college, and it is a matter of honor for me. Here, for 2 days, different or various types of eminent speeches are presented by great resource persons. Firstly, such as Dr. S.A.S. Sharma sir, my great senior student in our college life, Trivandrum, senior researcher, French School for Asian Studies, Pondicherry, on the subject of editing Sanskrit texts with a special reference to lesser known manuscript collection on behalf of the entire mission of this institution, expressing all my heartfelt thanks to Dr. S.S. Sharma sir. And also in this occasion, I express thanks to Gangadhari sir, who delivered a great speech in related to the aspects of the Sanskrit in the higher education possibilities and challenges on this current situation from my bottom of heart. Okay. And also today's occasion fulfilled in our hearts with the speech based on the history of our college through the tongue of our great, loved, beloved, respected Dr. C.M. Neelanandan sir, former professor of Sanskrit, Karadi University. With all my respect and love, expressing my thanks to him on the behalf of this institution. Here also, I am very grateful thank to Dr. Srinivasa Varkedi, Honorable Vice Chancellor Kavigura Guru Kalidasa University, delivered today's relevant and meaningful speech. Next is to my humble thank to today's great resource person, Dr. Amba Kulkarni, professor in the Department of Sanskrit Studies, University of Hyderabad, made a needful and effective, interactive, very valuable, essential speech delivered with the participant, especially in our college teachers, on the subject of NLP. Very, very, very interesting and interactive, very useful, especially from my college. And thank you for madam, thank you very, very, very thanks ma'am in this occasion. I am very, very happy. Once more, all my thanks to on the behalf of our college, to all the dignitaries, HODs of this college, and the teachers, students, and other participants, even out of Kerala and out of India. If anybody participate. Okay. And also, I thank to the coordinators of this program, especially Dr. Ajay Umar sir, and also Ajimon sir, Uday Umar sir, and once again, all my thanks to everybody for the success of this program. Okay, thank you
sir for your valuable comments.
Thank you.
Thank you also. Sarvebhyo bhi dhanyavadaha ye atra so avasthiti asmakam karyakraman धन्यं कृतवन्तः सर्वेभ्योऽपि पुनरेकवारं धन्यवादं कृत्वा इदानीं संस्कृत महाविद्यालयस्य पक्षतः सर्वेभ्योऽपि पुनः पुनः प्रणामं कृत्वा विरम्यते. धन्यवादः.
Thank you.